we're going to analyse some malware, and then in the second part, I'll give you a demo of a thing that affects. I think the last count was 980 million devices worldwide, and Google hasn't patched it yet, and has no intention to patch it. So if you have an Android device, then maybe you can probe your devices. Those Androids? Only 1, 2, 3, 4, five, four. It's a while. Those iPhones? Okay, well, you won't be part of it. Innocent and secure. It's no fun with iPhones, no fun. Android is much more fun to get into and to have a look around. Okay, so we'll do hopefully, if it all works, we'll do some malware. We'll get a real piece of malware. And I promise for this week there'll be nothing installed on the phone at all. It's a clean phone. Actually, last week when I set the demo up, I did the trick a little bit. I had a little backdoor, search TCP. So we'll go over that again, and that's one way, obviously, to get the user to install the malware. But this week, it's completely clean. I collect Android phones, old ones. Then we've got the old ones. Okay, so today we'll have a look at some malware analysis. So on average, as I said last week, 12 months to 18 months is how long an intruder can sit on a network doing stuff. Certainly the Sony hack and so on. The intruder is probably sitting there either as an insider threat, or they place some sort of malware onto the machine, and sitting there for a long, long time, and they'll often leave and clean, tidy up, and go. So they don't just stay there forever and ever. They'll get detected. They'll steal what they want. They'll get what they want, and then they'll leave. Okay. So there's the signs of the malware leaving the network. Okay. So often what we see is a jump-off point. A packer will pack the malware so that it obfuscates it, it changes it, it's not quite the same, so the idea is to pick it up, your virus scanner doesn't pick it up because it's got a new way of operating, a new signature. Okay, so we'll have a little look at some of the basic types in there. It's maybe better to put that one on, that one off. Okay, so we'll look at some software. Okay, like it or not, most of the security problems are caused by bad software, and bad software for testing. Many software developers pack it up and say, there you go, I've validated it, it works, I've checked the boundaries of the input, and I've checked for extremes, I put A in rather than a number, and it doesn't crash and stuff like that. But did you put lots of A's in? Oh no, I haven't got time to do that. So you find a lot of the dev and the DevOps actually don't spend enough time testing. Actually, you go into companies, and the one area that they're really worried about is their testing, especially of their web apps. C++ comes up a lot. Anything with C++ in it, anything to do with C++, is going to be compromised in some sort of way because of the way it deals with pointers, because of the way it puts all the text, as you've seen last week, it puts all the text inside the actual executable itself. So you don't have to do it to move it out, sensor. So if there's C++ in there, you're on stony grounds. Java is one of the worst and one of the most compromised of systems. JavaScript, Python, goes on and on. And the major problem is to do this cross-site scripting. HTML injected into HTML, it's JavaScript injected into your Flash movie. So it's a mangled mess. It's a quagmire just now, and there's an infinite ways that something can actually go wrong. Okay, so we'll look at some types just to recap what software is all about, how it runs and so on. And then we'll look at a basic taxonomy for malware. We'll try to understand the terms that are actually used. I don't think there's been a paper published on malware taxonomy. I may be wrong, maybe you can look for me, but I've not really found that. It's difficult because people call it an iWorm, Apple iWorm, and it wasn't. I used it. I published an article saying it was an iWorm, but it wasn't. It was a backdoor. It wasn't a worm. But the media liked that. Oh, it's an iWorm. Wow. I've got an iPod, an iPad, and I've got an iWorm. That's really good. Got my worms. iSpider. So they like to put I in front of it. And I'm sure it's probably copyrighted already. So it wasn't a worm. It was a Trojan backdoor. Users who didn't want to pay for software decided to go to pirate based type sites, download Photoshop and so on. The minute you do that, even though you've got a Mac, you're getting lots of backdoors, and you can package up whatever they want on these sites. You're not going to get the real deal. They're giving you Photoshop for free in Office and so on, and they're going to want something back. So what basically happened was that there's a whole lot of backdoors. Into the machine, did the dial back just like we saw last week. So the perception is it's Windows is the problem, and really it's not. All of them are just as bad as each other. Okay, so we'll have a look at basic taxonomy. We'll try to classify a few things, try to maybe put them into some boxes. But a thing can come in as a worm, and then it can be a backdoor, and it can be a Trojan. So we'll try to define that, and then we'll look at some of the methodologies that we use. The static analysis, looking at the disk, but increasingly there's a dynamic analysis. If the thing's running on a machine, don't switch it off. If it's there, the minute you switch it off, gone. Okay. So your malware is really smart. If you switch it off, then there's a good chance that someone will actually scrub the device or get rid of it or so on. So a lot of the focus now is on dynamic analysis. Let's see what it does. Let's probe it. Let's be its friends. Let's pretend to be the other side. Let's talk to it. That's okay. No, just sit. It's okay. Let's walk. So we really want to understand the malware, how it works, what it does, and so on. And as we'll find, it doesn't take too much skills these days to create this malware. There's a lot off the shelf that can be created. And we'll look at some code analysis. We've got to go down right into the machine, unfortunately, when we get into this type of thing. So I hate to break back, but we'll look at some assembler language code, x86. ARM, a knowledge of ARM in the future, these guys, billions of these machines, and billions of ARM type technology. So it's not a bad skill to actually learn a little bit of ARM and the ARM architecture and processing. Sorry, this is an old phone, I didn't smash it. Malware doesn't inform. Now that would be scary if it did that. It managed to punch its way out of the phone and to get out into the world. So really, the increasingly we're moving towards ARM and the Mac ones are still using the same code. So an understanding of x86 Intel architecture. It's not a bad thing because that's the Mac. The Mac does that. Even though it runs Linux, it's still using the same processes and registers and so on. And increasingly, it's memory. So when we look at the data loss prevention part of the course, we'll be looking at where data exists, data on the disk at rest, data in the machine, and data on the network. You think you're really safe, encrypted, great tunnels, everything's fine. And you go, oh, but it exists in the memory. Oh, we didn't think about that one. So we can actually have a look at the memory of the device, and there's the encrypted key. Microsoft used to have a great one with BitLocker. If you put your BitLocker to sleep, they very conveniently put the encryption key on the storage partitions. And you just have to put it to sleep, have a pop of the key, and you've got the drive encrypted. So really, memory is a risk area now, and what we can do is use tools to be able to analyze the memory as it's running, because with things like Heartbleed, what happened with Heartbleed, was that you can actually see the running memory of the server. So anybody who logged in last, so it was great, it was bad. These guys came on the TV and got change your passwords straight away, first thing you should do, they recite the same thing. Again and again, they bring these people out and they go, change your usernames and passwords. They haven't even looked at Heartbleed or Runner and run it through and analyzed and stuff like that. But they went through a standard script, change password. And they go, no, don't do that. The minute you do that, your password's in the memory and somebody's actually got it. So that can be really bad advice, but memory is a real place that actually most of the coders don't clean up. What should happen is they should clean up the area, but they leave it to the garbage collector to do that. Okay, somebody will get rid of that memory, and then these smart guys with that spray gun freeze your chips. You've seen the demo conference, they have a spray gun to freeze the chips. They open up the top of the laptop, freeze the chip, and the memory stays resident. Pop the chip out, you've got the encryption keys. Because the operating system has a lock on the memory. If you can do a worm boot, takes the lock off, and the memory's still there. So very few operating systems clean, flush the memory, because they want to get you started up as quickly as possible. It's always a challenge in Steve Jobs and Bill Gates as to how quickly you could get the machine started. So really, memory is a particular thing. So we'll be looking at some memory analysis to see if we can pop off some things there. Look at some forensic file analysis. We do a lot around fragments, identifying fragments of files. So you can pick off, if you're lucky enough, if you have the header of the file, you can pick off the file type, normally with a magic number. But there are some file types that you can look into the middle of it or the end, and actually pick off that it's the same file type. Look at some real malware running on XP unpatched. So we do have virtual machines that are running XP unpatched to be able to use. But what you've got to do is to make sure that you're not connected to the network at all. So in the lab next week, we'll do an introduction to the lab this week. In the lab next week, we'll get you to run an unpatched XP and look at a real malware and how it actually works and how difficult it is to get rid of it and what it does to hide itself. And at the very end, I'll look at NetWebKit, and then I'll give you the Android tool. Okay, so if you look at these are the three contenders for the software that causes the most problems at the current time. They've been in the top 10 for the last 3 years, and they're still there. Okay, so this is a basic toolkit of an intruder. And basically, I can send you a PDF one day. It's Bill. Have a look at this. This is the notes for this week. Oh, it's fine. I've got an open end. Not much in there. It's fine. If you've not patched your Adobe Reader, then there's a back door onto your machine. You now have a box. There's 2 million running bots in time in the world. It's waiting to be controlled by someone. And then the next day, you see a little flash move. movie and look at this lecture, it's really interesting. Do not pass your flash. A lot of people don't trust because it comes in with all this other stuff, like the cafe scanner and all the other things that's in there. But Trojan, to me, if you don't do your flash updates, many people don't because they don't like patching the machines because it has in the past. There are some applications I don't patch. Visual Studio is one. I just leave it alone because it works. It works. And I'm happy with it. I regret updating my Mac to Yosemite. It went badly. Oh, I've got to get this. It's going to be great. And my Dropbox decides to resync itself every day. Somebody tells them that there's a bug there, and they go, oh, "What's that? That's pretty bad." So many people won't patch. Many people are still running XP. You might be surprised, but the world still runs on XP and so on. People haven't moved to Windows 8. They haven't moved that much that they're now going to give Windows 8, Windows 10 away for. There's no place. What's the point of that user interface? So it's a they're flash. Two Adobe products. So I think that really highlights Adobe was responsible for the biggest hack of 150 million usernames and passwords. Flash has forever been criticized for its poor security, and basically it's a sinkhole into the machine. It's access through the browser and so on. So Steve Jobs didn't like Flash, told Adobe so. And kicked it off the iPhone. It kind of came back since then, but Flash doesn't really work on many devices now because it's not really that trusted endpoint. And then the last one has got to be one of the worst, and that's the Java exploit. So Java is one of the most difficult things to update on the machine. You go to the Oracle site and then you go this and that, and people, it doesn't go seamlessly. Not like your Androids, every day updates and stuff like that, patches. Java, you've called, you can force it, and your application is running against a certain framework, and it's got to be all right, and companies will typically stick at that one. So the Java exploit is one of the most readily available, because very few people pass the system. So those are the three main exploitable packages. There's your CV number, so that's what they're known by. And then these people here, PhoenixKit and CrimeBoss, create pre-scripted exploits for the intruder. Okay, pre-scripted, here's the PDF exploit. All you have to do is customize it for whatever you want, and then send that on. And you get a phishing service to go along with it. We'll email it for you. We'll gather responses. And so we'll target, we want to set an audience. We'll make sure that your PM goes out to the right people we know that are filling the tax return. So we'll have to send them out a PDF. So we're worried about their attention. So the Phoenix Exploit Kit is interesting because it, the chap who created that went on the run recently, lead on it. He was basically taking selfies of himself, catch me. Unfortunately, he got his photographs were tagged with GPS. So people were actually just watching his pictures coming through. I'm just going to knock on his door, and I've got some time. So just watch, if you go on the run, then make sure you turn your meta tags off on your photographs. Okay, so those are three. Most of the problems are caused by unpatched systems. Okay, so patch, and patch again. Always keep up to date. Everything should be patched up to the minute, and you don't avoid it in any sort of infrastructure. Heartbleed still has a major impact across the world. So many things actually have Linux embedded into it, web servers, it's a role of OpenSSL and that. Okay, so those are the three ones that are software itself, if we take it right through of the different types of software that we have, we either have compiled software or we have interpreted software. Which is faster?
Compiled.
Okay, compiled is faster. Why?
Because the code is close to the hardware.
So the code is matched exactly to the hardware of the device. It knows the machine code to use, knows the memory, it's able to move things in and out. Interpreter runs on the machine, runs the code in real time, and tries to interpret from the high-level language onto the specific machine code that's actually required. Okay, so it's always going to be slower, 10 times slower, roughly, for Java and C#.NET. 10 times slower. A C++ code will run 10 times faster than the Java code to work. So native code will always be faster. Which one is going to be the most robust when it runs? Both ways. Which one do you think will behave itself better? A compiled program? A C++ program? Or a Java, C#? Or a
Java.
Python program? Was it?
Java.
Say it again?
Java.
No. Java's better. Yeah, Java's better. It behaves itself better. Okay? Because it's managed. It's managed code. What, you want to do that? No way. No way, you can't access that. That's bad. C++, go ahead. just do what you want. You want to access that. That's okay. Blue screen, no problem. There's the door there. You want access to that memory over there? Yeah? Just go ahead. It's yours. Fine. But that's somebody else's? No, it's fine. Just I won't mind. Interpreted languages are much better because the framework themselves doesn't make them completely secure because of Java, you can see, because of all those problems, because the framework had a bug in it, and that drops things right through the framework. So the compiler, C++, Fortran, Basic, Delphi, and so on are high-level languages that are compiled. They go through a compiler, just what's called object code. That's almost like machine code, but it's got little gaps in it that needs to be filled to make it into a proper program. Needs all the little scaffolding to go along with it to really make it. It can't run on its own, as well as it's missing, it can't do it itself. So one time we had libraries that we'd bring in, especially on Linux, and we have all the other object code that we want, and then we bind it together with a linker and just are executable. And that's what's called a portable executable, and that's something that should run on the machine. So in terms of my Windows EXE, can I run that on Mac?
Not without any reader.
Yeah. So normally I wouldn't be able to, something like Wine would do it. So natively I can't run that on the operating system. So even though the architecture is the same, the operating system is actually different. Does anybody know how I could run a Core EXE on a Mac? On the other side, we have interpreted. So C# and .NET is an example. So we can create a .NET program, and .NET allows you to run, same with Java, it does, allows you to run on any type of machine. Okay, so when it runs, we bring in our DLLs dynamically. We just hope they're going to be there. We just hope that when we run the system, all our DLLs ready for us. We'll just hope they're nice DLLs. We believe the number of software developers that will check the DLLs. Oh, can I see yours? That doesn't look quite right. So you've got to watch that you're not bringing in the malicious DLLs, the bad ones that you just assume that they're all going to come in nicely. So our risk is obviously when we bring in bad ones because they come in at real time and can be replaced. So interpreted language, COBOL, BASIC, LISP, Python, Ruby, ASP, PHP, JavaScript, tickle, and so on, are all interpreted. Okay, so they're running an interpreter, the interpreter speaking in Hamlet language and translating it into the actual code that runs on the machine. Okay, so Python is a very good example of that. We have our script, Python script, it then runs it. Which one's typically the fastest to get up and running and off and ready? Compiled or interpreted? Compiled? Probably not. I would debate that sometimes, but interpreted is where you just want to get up and running. You know, and all that compiling and increasing stuff like that. So Python will typically use if we want to very quickly check hash code or stuff like that. So then that runs. And then what we've got is for our forensics analysis, we would run a debugger. So a developer would use a debugger to find the bugs. We use a debugger to step through the code to see what it's actually doing. Okay, a cracker will often take a piece of code, jump if not equal to zero, and they'll flip it to jump if equal to zero. So to jump if not equal to zero is the license fail. They'll flip that code, that one bit of the machine, that jump, and then it will actually jump, not that license, to the actual code itself. So the debugger is a good tool for us because that allows us to be able to run the code live and analyse what it's actually doing. Sometimes you've got to get onto the bench and actually watch what it's doing, what it's accessing, what it's filling in memory, what it's trying to access. And then every program can be reverse engineered. Java and C Sharp, you can do it in a fraction of a second. So with the decompiler tools that we have, with C Sharp and Java, within less than a second, the Java code comes back again, C Sharp, and so on. C++ is a bit more difficult, because it's a bit more difficult to reverse that back. But there's a whole lot of tools there that reverse the C++ code back into it. Do you know a method that companies will use? I mean, you use your whole IP for your company. Any idea of a tool that you could use to stop that from happening? There's a whole lot of obfuscators, and obfuscators completely scramble the code. They will pick your strings and encrypt them. They will mangle your for loops. They will change the variable names from nice ones to smiley face. Smiley face equals fine. I don't know if you ever tried to debug a program where you've got a variable called smiley face tilde something. It's not easy. So an obfuscator will generally go into the exe and trash it. It will still make it work, but it will trash it. It tries to kill the debugger. First thing it tries to do, there's a big fight between the obfuscators and debuggers. Because the obfuscators want to crash the debugger when it runs. Where on the other side, the debugger is trying to run it. So then we can look at the static codes and analyze from there. But if you've ever looked at some of the code, some of the malware code, it is just horrendous. It's been intentionally scrambled and mangled and it's horrible. And it works, and you go, how does that work? Honestly, how does that work? They will use non-printing characters. They'll use tilde 20 and change all the characters. The standard ones, the JavaScript one, it's not easy. When they write something, like 12 Days of Christmas, you actually see a complete mangled piece of text. It makes sense once you run it through the system, but to actually read it, okay, so that's the code that we have. And then the other way we can do it is to have an assembler where we can actually create the code as near as we can to the machine. And then that can be assembled to produce the object code. Okay, so this is the first one shows our traditional method of developing our code. We go from a high level language into our object code. Compiled exactly for the architecture, and then it produces a portable exe that runs on the operating system, that runs within a half hour. Okay, that's all. That's finished. That's the way we did it for many years, but it's gone. It's had its day. More commonly now, what we have is an intermediate image that allows us to run the executable on any program, any operating system that we actually want, and then we run it within a framework. It's a bit difficult to see from there, but there's the high-level code at the top there. The intermediate code is the bit after it, so you can actually see the code.
ASIC is an interpreted language. It's not a, isn't it?
If I put, oh no, you get to different types. You get something like GW Basic, which is actually a compiled. You get compiled Basic, and you also get interpreted Basic. You're right. Spectrum and all these things that can run. But you also could just an ABC. We used to work a lot in oil and gas. A lot of the programs in the oil and gas industry are written in Fortran and Basic, unbelievably, because they do the things that IS 232 quite quickly. So you can go both ways. Okay, so that's the intermediate code. It's a bit difficult for there, but when you see the slides, you'll be able to see what the code actually looks like. Hopefully, we'll go to do a little bit of reverse engineering of some code just to show you how easy it is for someone to do that. Okay. On the system itself, we have two rings. We have a highly privileged ring called ring zero on the Intel architecture. And that's where all the series programs run. We have high privilege. If a program gets in there, then it has all the privileges on the system. So a rootkit tries to get itself into ring zero and to be part of that. You can't call it a kernel, but to be part of the core operating system. And then we have ring three, that's where our DLLs typically run, and they have less privilege on the system. Increasingly, this is what we're doing. We're virtualizing our systems and our programs. So our executable runs within an operating system, which is then virtualized. So when we use our cloud here, you're just using a virtualized environment. It's running on VMware, vSphere, and each operating system is running in their own virtualized environment from there. So they should be as isolated as possible, hopefully. My virtual machine doesn't interfere with someone's next door, but it can. Memory shouldn't leak from, if you're all running in the same memory space, memory shouldn't leak from one virtual machine to another. So there needs to be a lot of isolation between the machines as they run. And then if you love your old ZX Spectrum games or some old computer that you used to have, then one way, obviously, to run it is within an emulator. So GNS3 is a Cisco emulator. You drop the Cisco iOS into it and emulates the hardware from there. These guys are about as close as you can get, because it takes a lot to take Cisco commands that have been written for a processor that isn't Intel, such as from Motorola, and translate that into an Intel architecture. So they tend to be very slow, but they allow you to emulate devices. So we get Android emulators, we get iOS emulators, and so on. We hope to be getting an IBM mainframe, perhaps before the end of this year, as part of our cloud. So we're building up our architecture, hopefully, the module. But you can get an IBM mainframe emulator that actually runs within your system. But it's quite a lot to be able to take code from another machine and architecture and translate that on into something like an Intel architecture. And the most evil of all, but probably the easiest to get us going there, is that we run within sites an application. So much of the malware that actually happens is the guy at the end there. You just write a little script. You've written your application so badly that my script just falls right through your application. You're running highly privileged and it can get access to the machine. So many rootkits, many shell codes drop through the application software. It used to be Microsoft Office that was the worst offender, but now it's Flash, it's PDF, and so on. So So the script might go through invisibly. Someone injecting script into it, just drops into the machine. It's possibly just shell code that the application doesn't even see that ends up dropping onto the machine and it's executed. Okay, so though the one at the end we'll see causes so many problems. So what's a basic taxonomy? So there isn't one, and I've tried to think around the basic stages of how malware actually works. Okay, so there's a certain classification. We'll just call it a worm, or we'll call it a Trojan, or we'll call it ransomware, or something like that. We'll put it into a box, roughly, so that we can tell somebody it's this. And it has a certain distribution method, so it might be peer-to-peer networks, it might be phishing emails, and so on. There's some way that it distributes itself, and it tries to hide. So it scrambles itself on the network, it changes the URL, it will do something to make sure that the user doesn't know that it's a piece of malware. This has got certain observable events that if we want to detect the malware coming into our network, it does something. It does something quite wrong. It has something in the URL, or there's a bit of, we can take a little sample of it, and we can use an IDS to be able to pick it up. And so, and then it uses a certain system compromise. So we'll see compromise that we'll use in the Android device is the interface between JavaScript and Java. Something kind of breaks down, and it goes wrong. So it's using a certain compromise. It then stays, wants to stay if it can. Might go to the registry, might stay in the memory somewhere. It tries to hang on from grim death to stay on the machine from there as possible. And then it can be found really by observing itself. It will do something wrong, it will start a process, it will change a file, it will go into a certain area, and alarm bells will ring. So there'll be something there, but it will try to hide itself. So malware will never do the same thing twice. Then it will do, it will change what it does, it will change the files it looks at, it will do, call itself something different than the registry, because it knows that the virus scanners are trying to pick up the operations. And then there's some trigger event, so I log into Google Mail, bing, I use the word Visa card, bing, and it becomes alive. So the Bolito pack in Brazil, what happened was that when anybody used the word Bolito in the browser, that's how many Brazilians pay for things using that currency, and the malware was written, so whenever the word Bolito came up, bing, it triggered itself and it started to observe. It took screenshots. Well, why does malware take screenshots when someone's logging into the bank? To get bank details, but often you'll ask for the second and third character or the fifth and the fourth.
Usually it doesn't show the letters.
It doesn't show the letters, yeah. So if there was a password there, yeah, it doesn't show the letters. So then for that, the key capture is turned on for that. But it needs to capture things like the Visa cards, number, to put those details and so on. So many malwares will actually turn on a key capture for the time of the event or take screenshots of the user. So there's some trigger events, and I'm trying to hide that because obviously we have a sensor. So one of the biggest growth areas just now in the industry is that I've seen it's growing at 25% and just now a lot of demand. SIEM is all about, look at this later in the module, it's all about logging everything. CPU, humidity, temperature, people, everything. Log it, and then you can play it back again. So then there's an observable attack method. Does some damage, and it's got certain objectives. So that's as near as the taxonomies we get for a malware. So what are some of the classifications? Again, there isn't really a proper classification. What we'll see when we do the lab is that we go to the website, we'll have a look at the virus that we're looking at, and we'll see that everybody calls it something different. Not too two of the malware analyzers actually call this thing. Some people will call it a Trojan, other people call it a worm. So there's no standard classification that we get really for them. We've got backdoors, we've got Trojan horses, we've got ransomware. Really bad one, you'll see that somebody goes to an objectionable site, a picture of a policeman comes up, with the Queen there too, and says, "You're nabbed, you've got your IP address, you don't give us £50, then we're going to tell the police, but it'll be okay. It's really bad what you've accessed, but it'll be okay, just give us 50. That sounds like the police of the future, the cops of the future. You've done a crime, just pay your fine now, and you're okay. So that's obviously a scam. The scam is just to check the gate, just go to a certain site, they'll pick up your IP address, which is difficult, and then they'll pretend, and they'll keep you on that page, try to click off, and they'll keep you on that page from there. So that's the ransomware type stuff. Triple Box is really evil just now. And it's evil. Is it against the law? Many people are debating it. The problem is that some of these crypto lockers actually have got bugs in them, so they go and encrypt. They will give you the key to encrypt your data, so they're nice that way. They will give you the key for keeping your data safe, that'll be well. But some of them will have bugs. They go, "Oh, sorry, the key doesn't work, sorry about that." Okay, so you don't have to pay us. So we have our ransomware, we have our exploits, our viruses, and our worms that all the problems in the past. So it's a bit difficult to see from there. Hopefully you'll be able to see it from the slides. So this is the malware that we'll look at as part of it. And what I've got there in total and virus total is that you'll actually see that every single of one of these companies actually calls the malware something different. So you can't just say this is this malware, because it changes so much. And they all call it different names. And what you normally get is a hash signature of it, hash value, and then you compare it online and it'll give you the details of it. But the first thing that we do is to be able to look at the executable, to look at the binary, to see if we can actually see anything actually in the file. And often, if it's badly written, you'll actually find even the name of the person who created it or the location. There might be some language translations. So in the Sony hack, we found some North Korean characters actually in the code itself. So there's normally something in the EXE that you can trace to find out and something about it. So there's a trace for strings, but certainly you want to take a thumbprint. Do you take a long thumbprint or do you take a short thumbprint? Should you just take a few bytes? Will that give you enough of a signature to be able to detect it? If I took 3 bytes from that analysis, would that be enough to capture it? No. So you need a long one, because 3 bytes are going to occur somewhere else, and you get a false positive analysis in the network. And then what you do is you do a dynamic analysis. So dynamic analysis is you actually run the thing and you only do this in a sandbox. So you need to make sure that you have a sandbox set up, you're not connected to the network, you're completely ethical. So try and set up your sandbox if you want. We've got a sandbox here. And you can run the thing and actually see what it actually does, what it touches. So our tools that we have is that we look at the files which have been accessed. So we use the SysInternals tools. We can actually see all the files that are accessed by the machine. We look at the registry, because the thing is forever looking in the registry and forever modifying keys and so on. So we actually want to see what's happening on the registry, and then we're looking at the processes and the networks, and also for the files that's actually been touched. So tools like Tripwire will allow you to be able to take a hash signature of all your files that are important. And then you can actually check if someone's changed the file, the hash signature changes, and you can trigger an alert on that. Okay, so another thing that we look at is obviously payload analysis. I'll show you a lot of payload. We'll be looking extensively at payloads in the next few modules. We'll look at network forensics. The payload will actually show you what the malware looks like if it's been carried in something. So it doesn't come in just as an .exe, it comes in as a zip file, and it's carried, zip files just don't appear on the network. It's carried by email, by something else. But when you look at the zip file in the email, it doesn't look like a zip file, it comes in as base64. So we'll have a look at base64, but just because something looks like something, you capture a signature, it will go straight through your IDS systems and all your scanners, because it's been converted into a text format. So that format there, the bottom for the red, is actually base64 type format there. So often what you do in your IDS is you pick off base64, the thumbprint, and so if somebody's converted it into that, into an email, and sent it as an email, that's what it actually looks like. So look in more detail at Snort, because Snort's a key part of our SIEM architecture and our scanning. You can see here, this is us actually detecting the malware in the email. But they're little pesky little things, these malwares. Okay, so when we look at this, we'll have a look at what actually touches. This is the place it wants to live. It's a bit difficult to see it from there. Hopefully we'll get the data kit to move back a lot more so we can actually see these things. But on the lecture that I've got in the slides, you'll be able to see in detail. But this is the key which actually starts the EXE up whenever the machine is booted. So that's obviously the place that you look and go to find out. And this is the executable here. So when the machine boots up, it starts lots of processes and executables. And in this case, it warms itself into here. But what this is showing actually, when we run the malware, and when we run it next week, it doesn't exist. It doesn't exist. So when we do a DIR, nothing there. The thing goes and sticks itself in this recycler bin folder, which you never go to. When was the last time you looked in your recycle folder? Look in your recycle bin. There's a little hidden folder on your machine called recycler that's there. It's hidden for you. You can't go in there and have a look at what's in there. This thing goes and sticks itself in there because it knows you're not going to be looking in there. You're not going to be going there. Then when you go in there, it creates a folder. Actually, it creates a folder with your unique ID. In the Windows domain, that's what your unique ID actually looks like. So it takes your unique ID, creates a new folder for it. It sticks itself in there. Or it doesn't because it's not there. And only when we look at the hidden files with the /eh, we actually see it. It's made itself a system file, it's made itself hidden, and it just does so much with the system attributes that it's almost impossible to see it, and to kill it is really difficult because the system now thinks it's a system file, and it's hidden, and so on. So it's actually quite difficult, and there's the guy there, there's the EXE, that's what links up with that one in there. So when your machine starts up, that's the guy that starts up. It changes its name every single time you install it, and so on. Okay, so code analysis is really where we end up. Sometimes, if we really want to understand how a piece of malware works, what's it doing, we'll step through it. So we can use a tool such as IDA Pro, which is standard in Kali, and free, I think, for most versions. And we can use IDE Pro to actually step through the program one line at a time and actually look at the registers, and memory, and the network connections, and so on. And that allows us to do our code analysis at one. Then we also use a debugger. In this case, we can look at the memory at any given time. We can look at the registers. An important area is the stack. Can anybody tell me what the stack is for? Why does everyone just do that? Was it?
Kind of a task schedule.
So you could normally. Variables, yeah. So when a process calls up a submodule, when a program calls up a submodule, it's got lots of variables. So it puts all the variables up in the stack, and then calls the program up, and then takes them all back off the stack. Does anybody know the way the stack works? Is it a first in, first out.
Last in.
Last in.
Last in, first out.
Last in, yeah. So it's a bit like when you've got the bank thing, you have the coins, put the coins in. The last one in is the first one. So that's the way the stack works. And the stack doesn't work, and then the system doesn't work, and it will crash. Because all these things that are getting passed, the variables, won't actually work. So we're going to look at the stack. We can also have a look at the disassembled code, see what that actually looks like. And so this is an example here of what our machine code actually looks like. So even just a little task like A is equal to 1, becomes this here. There's B is equal to 2, becomes that. A plus B becomes these three commands in there. So these are the assembly language codes. So the machine is forever moving stuff around between memory into the registers, doing something with them, and then moving them back into memory again. So those are the standard things that really the program's doing all the time. That's an example of some of them that we actually get. If we go through the debugger, you actually see the commands as they actually change. It's a bit difficult to see from there. But what we've got here is that when we have the square brackets, that moves from a memory location, whenever you see memory location, it moves that value into the memory location. This is a pointer to the memory. And then sometimes we've got operations that involve the registers themselves. We can't actually see from there. So as we go through the program, it will generally change each of these registers that we get for each one. The way that we've created our programs actually is really quite messy. We use a von Neumann architecture. It works just now. Many people are looking at new ways to do computers. But actually, the data and the code share the same space. And they kind of fight all the time. And that causes a lot of problems. Because the code is running, and then the data is just below it. And then the code decides it wants to be part of the data. It starts to overrun it, and so on. So we have this mixed area between code and data that we actually run. And then there's a number of registers in the device that have been used as part of the program. Okay, so there's an example of putting stuff on the stack there. And the stack is generally a first, last in, first out type approach. Okay, so there's the operation happening there. So we have our code, we have what's called an instruction pointer. Instruction pointer tells you where you are in the code at any given time. And whenever we call up routines, our data goes onto the stack and then it gets popped back again from that. And then we have our forensic analysis. So we've looked at our dynamic analysis. Now what we have is our forensic analysis to be able to see if we can spot our different file types and so on. So most file types has a magic number in there, not at the start of the file. So if you look in, if you find FFD8, there's a very good chance that that's a JPEG. It can occur in any other file, but at the very start of the file, that normally identifies a JPEG. Flash files are 465753 or FWS. So when you look at it from a forensics point of view, that first header, the first few bytes, usually identifies the file type that you actually have. So if you bar flash movies on your network, if you see those three bytes together, there's a chance that there's a flash movie in the contents of the file. Okay, so there's a whole lot of these things that give you, and we'll be looking at more detail on how we can get Snort and Wireshark to detect these things. So I have billions of packets. How do we quickly find the flash file? Straight away, we normally use regular expressions and the magic number to be able to do that. But there's nothing to say that somebody doesn't encapsulate a file. So if I put a flash file into a zip file, will I be able to still see the FWS? So I zip up my flash file and I'm watching the network. Do you think I can still see?
No.
I can, because it's compressed. What I can see, hopefully, is the sign of a zip file, because I have it there. But it'll have a zip header to it. do when you're analyzing your malware. So this is a flash file. Is that you get spec up for flash, and you look at the format. So someone will have published somewhere the details of what the format is, how it operates, and so on, and what's in places. Okay, so this is an example. This is a trace of the flash file, and you actually go and you can actually look at the details of each of the fields actually within it. So you get down to that detail to be able to find out the basic parameters that are involved in the flow. So just before we have a break, I'd like to see an exploit kit. So this is the KineBoss exploit kit, which is a bit difficult to see from there. And this one has all three of the vulnerabilities. So it has a toolkit for anyone to be able to take those three vulnerabilities that show at the start and create the Flash movie, the PDF, and Java. So I have one for you. All pre-prepared, all banging stuff. So this is what it actually looks like. So this is a Flash file here. And what it does is that it injects JavaScript into the Flash movie. And it's a well-known bug in it. And then what it actually does is it then loads, it's a bit difficult to see from here, it then loads shellcode onto the machine to give it a backdoor actually into it. Okay, so this is the type of kit that's available from the for script keys and for anyone to modify. So there's no way you can stop people from using these. People will pay a license fee to be able to maintain and get updates and get bug fixes or reverse bug fixes. So when a system is patched, they will update the malware. So on the website, I give a demonstration of that. Okay, so what we'll do, we'll have a break for about 5-10 minutes. Right then, so we'll look at some real life sort of malware. So one is that we install something on the device and it does the callback. And the second one is that we trick the user to be able to go to a certain place and then there's some exploit of the actual device. So what we'll look at is the web view exploit. So anyone who has Jelly Bean, anyone who has Android 4.1.2 or 4.2 and so on is exposed to this. And Google's statement on this is this, is it not? They're not really patched. They're not interested in patching earlier versions to 4.4. It's up to the mobile phone providers to possibly look at these things and the vendors and so on. So this is Microsoft, God bless their soul, is that they patch every single system that they've created regularly. So you actually start to worry that Google is refusing to patch the systems that are there, because it's so difficult for them, because they do the code, they write for the Nexus, and Samsung have got to go away and port the code onto their device, and then HTC's got to do the same again. For all their devices, it's quite a difficult task. Now, if you think Samsung are probably only going to focus on the latest phones to make sure that Lollipop works on them so they can sell them off the shelves, for the old stuff that's out there, the billions of phones, that's a difficult task there to do it. So if you actually look at the current state of the market, earlier versions of Android, there's 60% of them that are running the older version of Android at this specific thing, which if you do the math, ends up as 980 million devices can be exploited through the exploit that we'll actually have to look at. 900 odd million devices are unpatched at this present time, and we'll see how easy it is for somebody to trick a user to visit our website, and then they have complete access to the phone. But Google said, so that's where we are. So the current market is that the Jelly Bean still has a considerable share. Jelly Bean one is the bit at this quadrant down here. This is the Jelly Bean market at the current time. And obviously there's a lot of people that aren't using their phones, that just buy new ones. But you've got to remember that maybe in the developed world, in some countries, everybody upgrades to the latest versions. In many other countries, their Wi-Fi and their network connections are actually quite poor. So it's just not automatic that people are able to update their operating system. So I'm just saying that 60% of all the phones, of all the Android phones, are at risk from the vulnerability that we're actually going to look at. Okay, and so the whole world of patching is going to look a lot different in the world of mobile phones. When you have a closed system like Apple, then you can do it, and you've got constraint over your platform. But in the Android space, it's really up to the vendors to be able to patch and update. It's up to them to push. Has anybody got a Lollipop here? Yes. There's one. I mean, you can get it. The HTC certainly have it just now. So it happens quite slowly, and you can see the patching also happens quite slowly. Okay, so the vulnerability that we'll actually have a look at is this one, which you can't obviously see from here. But basically what happens is something goes wrong between the JavaScript and the Java engine, because JavaScript uses a Java engine to be able to run its code. So the WebView exploit, something breaks down in there, and then it manages to run this shell code here. This shell code here basically says install the exploit onto the machine, which installs the Metasploit framework onto the device, and Metasploit framework is then compatible by the intruder. Okay. So the intruder can have multiple connections onto it. So the one that we did last week was this reverse TCP. We did the reverse TCP again for that. I'll repeat that one again. But this one now is much more serious. I did install something actually on the device. It's just what Metasploit actually created. So stop it. It's that one there. Okay, so you can see that. So Metasploit created the package that I put on these machines. So I think I did tell you last week that I did do that. So I wasn't tricking you at all. Okay. This week, nothing. Okay, so I've taken two phones, all smashed ones. Yeah. Really smashed. I promised there was nothing installed on them. The only thing is that they're running Android 4.1.2 on them, where obviously they're running at 4.4.2. Okay, so don't break your phones, please. If you're going to do this at home, don't. Just watch. Be very careful of what you're actually doing. Okay, so we're going to have a look at next one. So if you want to test your phone just now, do you want to quickly, you got a QR scanner on your phone? Do you have a QR scanner?
I do.
Yeah, go on. See if it works. Go and scan it. Scan it. It just does. It's okay, there's no back door here, I promise. There's no back door here. This is just going to let off. It's going to do a little test on your phone. Did it work?
I think I need to go a bit closer.
It doesn't quite work. Scan okay?
It's a website. It's a purchase.
scan. Do you have any more? You're curious.
What happens when that person installed what?
She's okay, everything's fine. What does it say?
Should I purchase it?
Oh, you've got to cancel that. That looks like, oh sorry, I've obviously got the pixels around the way. Just cancel. I'm so sorry. Now you did the wrong side. Is it okay? It's okay?
Yeah, it's okay.
Did you manage to cancel it?
Yeah.
Is it? Did you manage to cancel it?
Actually, I'm interested in the item.
All right, yeah. Go ahead and buy it. So let's actually see what happens. I'm not connected to the Wi-Fi just now. you can try it yourself. But it does go to the site to see if you'd like to purchase something. If you actually click on the link,
just
to cancel.
Yeah, I canceled
it. And it should say that you've now bought two. Every time you try to cancel it, it adds in another one of them. Okay, so because the professor said something, you actually followed. So you trusted me enough to follow the link. This is the right, the one, hopefully, here. So what I'm going to do is I'll go over the one that we did last week, just so that's fresh in your mind, and then we'll have a look at the web view one with the attached Android. Okay, so I've got my Wi-Fi. I'm on a private network. I can assure you, everything's fine there. And hopefully can you see that a little bit. Kind of tell roughly what's there. Right then, so the reverse TCP one, we're basically just setting up our payload to be able to do as a callback. I've set it up so that it will call back on port 443, so it does a 443 back. To the machine at 192.168.0.0.24. So just let me set my local host and my local port on the machine. And we should be good to go. Okay, so it's just listening on port 443. I can't believe you still trust me to get these devices. Okay, so now we've actually got session two is actually open in there. So if you remember, so we now have access to the phone because it's kind of about dial back. The exploit opens up the Metasploit framework. We can also have a look at the cameras. So what we'll do is we'll just capture the front camera, as we did last week. You ready?
Yeah.
I think it's the other one, so you might want to take back away. It's going to take a picture of you.
Oh, just
that's not very interesting, is it? So we'll try that again. Try another one. Ah, there you go. So it looks like I'm falling off something now. Okay. So that was the reverse TCP. And obviously that can happen on any device, Windows, Mac. Matter, you create the exploit for the device, it will do a dial back item for you. So the expert writer would have to get it onto the machine for it to actually do that. But the web view one is much more sinister in that it restricts the user to click on a link, and it could look like a link that's actually okay, and it exploits it. So I'll let you have a look at the Wireshark trace a little bit later on in the module to see what actually sends to it. But what it's really doing is creating the payload that's required to set the server up and to be able to send the code back to the device to be able to get access to it. So just let me get set up again. Okay, so this is my exploit here. Okay, and I just need to set up a few little parameters, like my host again. And then I'll set up, so we can show our options if we want to see what the parameters are that we can set. We can change different ports that we connect to, we can create a different folder, and so on. There's a whole lot of things that we can actually set up to customize this. But what we'll do is we'll set up our URI path to be security. So what should happen is it'll create, by default it creates it on port 8080. So if you look there, server port 8080 has been used. Just in case I'm running a web server on Kali already, it just moves it away from there. I could change the server port to be anything that we want. We could have 443 if we wanted, but in this case it's 8080. And then what we'll do is that we'll just run it now. All ready to go. Okay, so let's, what will we try first? So let's find the QR code again. Don't worry. Is it getting it?
Yeah, I know.
No.
You need to okay it,
otherwise it will not open the page. Thank you. That wasn't that easy. Right then, so let's try over here just to see if there's a bias towards that side of the. It's a really smashed up one. But it should work okay. Do you want to scan that?
Internet connects.
Oh, sorry. I just need to request cannot complete because it's. So I just need to connect. Need to connect to my Wi-Fi. Just give me 1 minute. I'll get my Wi-Fi connected there. Just need to connect to there. It's got an IP address, so it should be okay. So sorry about that. So if we go back and we go to QR scanner. No working?
Any browser?
Go for that one. Go for the Mac one. Do it. Or will you keep that until there and in the back. Okay. So nothing really much has happened there. So but when we look at it, we now have two sessions. These phones will try to reboot themselves. You know what, like some of these mobile devices that might end up rebooting itself, but I've now got two. Does anybody else want to join? Does anybody have an Android 4.1, 4.1.2 on the phone?
can join if you want, and I'll go to them. Okay, so we now have two connections there. So let's go to the first one. And I can resume the session. So the sessions are sitting there, dangling, staying connected all the time, and then I can flip between each of the sessions. So that's session one, and that's session two. So hopefully we can actually, this should give us our first one. Good. And then we can exit out of that session, and then go to that one. So you can actually see that this is a really serious flaw and quite a bad one, that someone can actually get access to the phone from there. And everything we saw last week on the device, all the call logs, and we'll try the record mic just to see if that works this time. So I'm speaking to the phone now. Say hello.
Hello.
Again.
Hello.
Okay.
This course is amazing.
Oh, it's failed. So sorry about that. But that's certainly possible. But you can see all the commands that we actually have. So we should be able to actually look around the phone. So I think I think our images are in SD cards. And then DCIM. Look at the images in there. But we have the complete connections. Both connections will sustain for as long as.
What if you have like banking app with your phone? Can you access that and do like forensics on it?
If you hook on to a privileged process, and you can get full admin rights to be able to run any application. You can look in any area actually on the phone. Everything is it's a standard Linux device, the etc. folder is there.
Do you have a keyboard lock, for example, or a key lock?
And that's what you can now install any programs onto the device, including something like a keylogger from there. I mean, we now have that device. Both devices, and I promise there is nothing. These are taken from a dumpster. Really, very old phones that are smashed up. There's nothing special in there at all, and it just shows you the importance of patching. So if you're not on Kit Kat, then you've really got to worry. If you're still on Jelly Bean, then this exploit is there to be.
How does it work over the LAN? Because obviously at this point they're connected to this Wi-Fi within one LAN. How does it work over the LAN or over the network?
My site would have been on the internet, so my site would have been hmrc.gov.me. So that URL that I show, you from your phone are calling the internet.
Mm-hmm.
So I do it to be ethical, to stay within sites. This network, but an intruder would set up a website somewhere,
right.
You to click on it, and when it goes to the browser, so you can try the browser itself, it just comes up with a blank page, and the user wouldn't actually know that what they have actually done was to go somewhere else that really wasn't quite valid. So, do you understand that the user is dialing out, so you need the reverse TCP? More because it's the device that's calling the internet. The intruder sets up a Metasploit or the website, sits on the set port, could be 80 quite easily, and then when they connect the phone to it, 980 million people, possibly, not at the same time, of course, that'd be difficult. But so you can see that's what that's.
Yeah, but you still need some software, some stuff running on that mobile phone.
No, I promise. There's nothing. I promise. Have a look.
I wouldn't see it. My first Android phone that I have.
It's fresh. I checked
it.
It's
fresh.
See, the website is activated. The Metasploit is activated by you outside the Metasploit.
So this is Metasploit that creates it for you. But it could run as that, but obviously they could just create their own site. I'll actually I'll let you see what they. We'll be doing a lot more Wireshark stuff and tracing our data packets and so on. But I'll let you have a look to see what goes on in between. If I can just find the PCAP file. I'll try and get the data protector fixed, because really it's not a very good. It's very difficult for you to see that, isn't it? So I'd like to have a little look at what that actually looks like on the line. Try to find where it is. So this is our web view here. Can anybody see that? Does that look like crayon? Looks like crayon from here. So this is the initial connection that I made to 24 with Wireshark, as we'll find out. So there's the GET. The GET is the thing that actually calls up the website. So what we normally do with Wireshark is that we follow the stream, and this is the red. Is the red me or my phone, or is the red the website, do you think? Let's try looking at that. So Wireshark shows you the two sides. So this is the red is the phone. So the phone says GET/security, as we've seen before, at some port 8080 hopefully. And then the blue is what comes back. And if you actually look at the blue, there's all the lovely JavaScript. And there's the shell code, actually, there. And the thing with shell code, it's actually very difficult to be seen. It's got hex numbers in there. So that's really just to obfuscate on the line there. But that's what Metasploit is delivering back to the phone, which exploits the Java script to Java. Fungibility, as I showed you actually. Any other questions?
If you close the website, is that the connection?
It's all closed, yeah. There's nothing running here. There's nothing at all. No web browser open.
So do you end the connection if you
But that's a QR code. So the connection is there's no actual running connections actually in there. So it stays, the connection stays.
Is there any way you can edit your phone?
You would have to see this button here. That's it. Pressing that a lot, and that's the only way you can get rid of it. Now, I can create another connection just to show that, and if you go to through the web browser, then it actually shows that you can close the web browser, and the session will start to be open. There. See, they're still there. What's that one? Still got your one. So the sessions are still there. So the sessions stay active. There. We have a whole list of them, and now we'll have a look at your phone. So we'll go into sessions 2. There's that chair. So you can tell it's that chair is over there. For that one. So you can go back, and all you did was the QR code, and it just automatically. So the QR code is always a convenient way for a URL. So rather than typing URLs, but it could quite happily be a URL. And really, what it's exploiting is the cross-site scripting. some code is injected, you find a vulnerability, and then cram in some code that actually causes, in this case, the shell. But the shell could be anything.
Is there an option to do it without having to scan the QR code?
Oh yeah, oh, I should have done one without a QR code. You want to type in that? You want to type in
that in my mobile?
No, this one. Is this your one?
This one.
Sorry. You can have a smartphone. Sorry, that. What version have you got on that?
That's 4.3.
What happens with a KitKat?
4.3. Oh, interesting. Right. Okay. So I don't know if you can type on the.
It's not
so easy to type.
So I take it in Android phones you don't have the possibility to show your running tasks because that must be running something in the background.
That's exactly
keeps
right.
The connection.
Yeah. So if you root your phone, you can obviously look at all your tasks and use PS and things like that. I mean, we can look at the tasks if we wanted. We can run a PS and look at all the tasks that are actually running on the device at this particular time. So you find out.
How would you know what's the phone ID?
It doesn't matter, they're calling us. So if I want your phone, then I send you a link, you dial in, I know it's your. I mean, you can tell all the details of the phone from.
Because you can read out the ID, my number, and phone numbers, and all this stuff.
Yeah.
See, from a forensic point of view, how can you trace back to your phone to ever?
But there's no login actually on the device. If you wanted, you could run a login just the same way as we'll be doing in the lab. And the next device will run a login.
So if you forensically investigate the phone to see if there was a, there's
you'll
no trace or anything.
You'll find no connection, and that's the problem with a lot of mobile phone forensics. Is they've got call logs and things like that, things like network connections in, it doesn't log because it's not got a lot of memory. And then it doesn't want Apple have been sued because they advertised they had a certain amount of memory there for the user to use and it wasn't really there. So the vendors have got to watch that they're not eating up. That could be a vulnerability, somebody fills up your logs, passes your phone and so on. So it'll tend to avoid these kind of things. So just let me find my happy website just to show you that
do you
want to type in that URL?
HTTP?
Just let me get it set up again. Don't press the button until I get it set up again. So this time it's not a QR code. Sorry, I only use the QR codes. I know QR codes are pretty rubbish. I just made it so it's easy because it's not so easy to type in. But obviously it would be just a simple URL. That would actually be running. So just let me very quickly get that done. So don't enter it yet, okay? So set the host again, 192.168. So only ever do this so what did I say? Security.
I'll
assume you were typing it.
That's
securityside.com. Oh, no, it's not that one. It's not so easy to type in, actually, on a phone. But obviously, it could have any port. It doesn't have to be 80. It doesn't have to be /security. It's just that one of the options that I said for it was can you remember it now?
Yeah.
Can we go back to Cali?
Should I go?
No.
Start it?
Stash. Oh, you forgot about the 80. I'm sorry. colon, it, I should have put it on port 80, I know that. It's the symbol thing. So I've just placed it on 8080, so when you visit the link, it's got colon 8080, and then it's an folder called security. Yeah, go for it. Vroom, vroom. So if you want, I'll show you my HTC. This is Kakao. Okay. It's not Lollipop yet because I've not released the code officially. Yes, I don't like to demo. So I'll go and do it. So since you don't trust me to use your own phones to go and do an assessment, I'll show you what happens when I access it. So I'm there. I can type this in fast enough before the bell goes. Nothing there, maybe you agree, but so that was through a website. So disappointing, isn't it? Mm-hmm. I've not got vulnerability on my phone. So if you read that, it says no vulnerability actually on it. So the exploit is checking the code that has to come back from my HTC. It's KitKat, so it doesn't actually have the vulnerability. So you can see it didn't manage to create the. Does anybody want to try to connect the bell to Wi-Fi? Go on, just go and do it. Go and do it, please. If you got, go on, you do it. Connect the bell. Connect the bell as Wi-Fi. There's no password on it.
Does the
4.3
have the vulnerability?
What is it?
4.3.
It might not. Who knows? Is there anybody connecting it?
What's
the
website again?
Oh.
Please be gentle.
Be gentle. Do you want to do the QR code? It's 192.168.0.24.880/security. So you're fine? You're okay?
Yes.
Oh, I would be so disappointed. I'm so disappointed. I keep my old OpenSSL for Hardwood. I just keep all the old versions of the computer. I'd be really disappointed, obviously.
Do I have to shut that
down? It's okay, I've got all your data, so just give it a minute to sync. Just sync in your background. Got your credit card details and all that kind of thing. That's okay, we should go. You got any bitcoins in there?
No.
We'll have a little look. Okay, oh, we've got quite a lot there. Good.
He's just refreshing it.
All right, okay. Well, you definitely haven't many times. It's not going to happen for you. Let's see. Okay, so actually, the sessions are still. Whoops. Session is still there for the one that we had. I think it was this one here. So I just resume my session, which is session number one. I promise there isn't any. Have a look at it in the lab if you want. You can examine it, you can reset it. It's purely running 4.1.2, and this vulnerability isn't patched at all, and it's unlikely to be patched anytime soon from that. Okay, so I hope I haven't scared you too much. I hope the key messages, I've got your bitcoins, so you're okay. The key messages are this is a really tough area, malware analysis. There are so many ways that someone can get in and actually do things to get a contact point onto the network. And you see, just by exploiting a vulnerability like this, then users are at risk. Okay. gets a smile. Let's do a Mexican wave. Can you do a Mexican wave? Right, here we go. Start over here. Come on. There you go. I'll end the light. Excellent. There you go. Well done. That's good. You come down the front next week. You're going to be my assistant. Because my assistant's down the front. Oh, I have to put a URL in. Yeah. I'll give you some instructions next week so that you know actually what you're
expecting.
Okay. So today we'll not be doing any malware analysis. You'll be disappointed to know, actually. We'll be doing our cloud again, just so that you're up to date. We're trying to build up our architecture. We'll have our Windows server, Ubuntu, and we're dropping Kali this week. We're using pfSense, that's the firewall we're going to use. So sorry we did Beata last week. This week we're going to do a proper firewall, and we'll get our Beata set up. Once we're set up, then we can really start to build up the whole architecture, start to be running our IDS systems and looking at our code, running on machines, and so on. If we're very lucky, we'll end up with an IBM mainframe sitting on the network.
So is it running AIX, or is it running
the
mainframe?
For the mainframe, in the virtualization, we can talk about it in the lab. Okay, right, well, thanks very much. Anybody have any other questions? So we managed to finish in time. So thank